showing up at 9 a.m. On a Saturday. I'm Viral Shah. I'm one of the co-inventors of the Julia language, and we even have we have Shashi out here, who's a core Julia contributor. We have Ravi Mohan out here, who's also a Julia contributor now. And as you can see, the Julia community in Bangalore has already grown threefold. Last year, it would have been just me maybe giving this talk. Today, we are three Julia people out here. Are there others that I don't know of? Maybe anyone else who has tried out Julia has used it out here? Okay. Okay. Julia box, okay. Okay, so what have you done with Julia? Just kind of test the waters, okay. All right, so, you know, this is functional conference, right? So I guess I should really be talking about some functional aspects of Julia and stuff like that, but I mean, I think you guys all know all that stuff, right? Your maps and folds and filters, and I'm not a huge fan of them anyways. what I'm planning to do is I have a whole bunch of demos actually, and hopefully these will motivate, you know, why Julia, why did we even need a new language, and what are some of the design criteria, the design things that we went through, and what I would like to do is make this completely interactive to as much of an extent as possible, so that, you know, it's not just me giving a monologue, but I'd really like sort of people to ask questions as we go along, challenge me on stuff. I'll try to say stuff that hopefully will evoke people to challenge me. So with that, let me start off. So Julia today, some of you might wonder, right, where it is, what it is, why is it even interesting? The Julia community is about 100,000 users today, is our estimate, at a pessimistic level. It's being taught in about probably, 30 to 50 universities as course material. It's, IIT Bombay yesterday came out, there was an article in Economic Times, IIT Bombay had this $100 laptop. Anyone saw that article or heard about this $100 laptop? So they just git cloned Julia and typed make, and 8 hours later Julia was running on the $100, IIT laptop, the ARM book. So, people are just kind of taking Julia, putting it on Raspberry Pis, putting it on netbooks, putting it on, their servers, putting it on, doing their analytics. People are doing all kinds of stuff. People are using it for research. I'd like to maybe mention a couple of very interesting use cases. I don't actually have real slides. I just have a bunch of IPython notebooks. So I'll just talk about some of the use cases that I've seen people using Julia. One of the things I like to do is send people to the JuliaCon website, the JuliaCon videos. So if I go to YouTube and look at the Julia language. So we had JuliaCon 2015. That was that just happened in June. And there were an amazing set of talks, right? So there are 61 videos that I actually ended up uploading eventually. But some amazing talks, and I would really like to sort of maybe highlight some of these. And the reason I'm just showing you this YouTube page is so that if you find this interesting, you can actually go and check these things out. So there was this next generation airborne collision avoidance system. This is the FAA that is using Julia for writing the spec of the next generation collision avoidance system that will go on every aircraft. So 3 years from now, Boeing will get this is my understanding, this may not have any bearing to reality, but as I understand it, Boeing in theory should get an executable spec that is written in Julia, which is completely sort of souped up with metaprogramming. So the spec generates the flow charts, the code, the documentation, the test cases, all comes from the same code base, and it's also executable. So you can actually, what goes on your system will be what you've actually been given. So it's not a paper specification, it's an executable specification. And Robert Moss, who gave this talk, believes that Julia can actually become a standard for specification in avionics. There was another one by, there's another one on 3D printing, I think, yeah. Jack Minardi, 3D printing with Julia. So this is an amazing application where this company Voxelate, which builds amazingly cool materials, they're a material sciences company and they have their own 3D slicer. And the entire code that powers the 3D printer is actually written in Julia. So you have the entire geometry engine that controls how the head moves and, you know, puts the ink around and builds up. So they have amazing materials that not just lays out the mechanical structure, but also lays out the electronics. So they actually have this amazing demo of a quadcopter. If you see this video, it's like they hit enter and then this printer starts printing, and then when it's done printing, this thing just starts flying. Like, it's pretty cool. So that's another really cool application. I mean, I'm trying to kind of pick out applications that you may not have heard of or that are sort of, you know, interesting and stand out. There's a bunch of guys doing quantum simulations with Julia. There's a bunch of guys doing data science with Julia. Oops, I didn't mean to click it. And so on and so forth. Julia in astronomy. Oh, there's another great one. There was this one on economics, actually. Let me point that one out. So this is a team at New York University that's working with Professor Thomas Sargent, who got the Nobel Prize in economics in 2011 or 12 for macroeconomic work. And his team has essentially moved to Julia. He's put out a textbook that gives all its examples in Python and Julia today. Their team working with the New York Fed is actually moving the New York Fed's models of the US economy from MATLAB to Julia. Great, right? It's open source, it's high performance. You know, everyone in the community is beginning to use it, so makes sense. So all kinds of interesting applications are beginning to move to Julia. And, you know, why this excitement, why this movement, right? I mean, why do we need another language? That's the question I asked myself when we started this in 2009. Like, does the world really need a new language? I mean, you know, if someone came to me and said, I started a new language, I would ask, why would you do that? And we asked ourselves the same question. But at least when we started, you know, I come from, even though I'm a computer scientist by training, I actually come from sort of a world of scientific computing where there was a lot of Fortran, a lot of MATLAB. R kind of started coming in from the world of statistics. Python started becoming increasingly popular in the last 5 years for numerical computing. But your traditional computer science languages don't show up in this world at all, right? Like Fortran is probably the last and probably the first and the last intersection there. And I don't think anyone probably uses, any real computer scientist uses Fortran, right? Is that a fair statement? But, you know, we have what, 20 years, 30 years of scientific legacy that's in Fortran today. So the real question that was sort of staring us was, can we have a programming language that's high performance, that's good computer science, that's good numerical computing, that's good for algorithmic work, and that's also productive? So is something that has all these features even possible or not, right? And everyone, until Julia came out, until 2012, when our first blog post announcing Julia went live and got 100,000 hits in a couple of days, people believed this was impossible, that you cannot have a language that is interpreted and dynamic and, you know, high productivity at the same time as something like C or Fortran, which is high performance, right? It was thought you had to pick one of the two. You could not have both together. But I think, you know, enough has been discussed on this topic and the proof is out there, right? You can download Julia and see that is actually as good. As I say it is. So julialang.org, if you're online, just go to julialang.org, that's the website, and you know, that's where the project is, and you know, some videos out there, and some very interesting benchmarks. Maybe let's look at this plot out here, as it loads up. So this is a benchmark of these very simple things in Julia, right? It's the Mandelbrot set, it's your integer parsing, some arithmetic which computes pi, you know, printf benchmark for some string stuff, a quick sort benchmark that tests your array access, and, you know, nothing exciting about these benchmarks, right? I mean, like, what's the big deal? And these are the languages in which these benchmarks were implemented. Now, you know, a caveat is that if you look at these implementations are not meant to be how an R user would write this benchmark or a Python user, right? So for example, for quicksort in Python, you would never write the quicksort algorithm in Python. You would say sort, right? And probably it will do something under the hood. But the purpose of these benchmarks was not that. The purpose of these benchmarks was to figure out how you know, something that can be expressed as you know, 10 line code, 10 line quicksort implementation. If you express the same 10 lines with roughly the same algorithmic styles, right? Your recursion, your array accessing, your all your control structures and so on and so forth. How well do they do in each of these languages? So Mandel, right, for example, that tests how good your complex number implementation is. And the basic takeaway is that, okay, so the way you read this chart is these are ratios to C. So for example, if I pick Go, and this is this pink thing out here, so quicksort in Go is as fast as quicksort in C. Okay, that's what this means. But this orange thing out here, which is randmatstat, this thing is a random matrix statistics implementation, and that in Go is 10 times slower than C. Where's Julia out here? Yeah. So as you can see, Julia is all bunched up close to, you know, so this line out here, this line is C. If you're on this line, you're as fast as C. Okay. So Julia has the tightest bunching of all these languages. And as you can see, these are the languages that people like to use when they're doing scientific, exploratory, data science work. These are the languages that people like to use for deployment or actually sort of, you know, doing high performance stuff. So Julia kind of sits right in the middle. It's got the features of these, it's got the performance of these, and it's, you know, this chart kind of shows where that comes from. So that's a little bit on Julia benchmarks. I would invite you to not believe me at all and write your own program in Julia and see if it's fast or not, or if it meets your expectation, right? And if you're keen to use Julia, you can download it from julialang.org right now, or go to Julia box. Actually, I should do this in an incognito so that it doesn't log me in. So if you go to juliabox.org, a large part of which has been designed by Shashi out here and Tanmay, who's not here right now, but in Bangalore. If you go to juliabox.org right now, you'll be able to see, you know, a page like this. And then you just sign in with your Google ID and you'll get a rich notebook interface where you can follow along with some of the basic things that I do, but not the more advanced things because I have all the libraries configured out here. All right, so maybe it's a good time to maybe take a little bit of a break and see if people have any questions, or maybe even if I can get a raise of hands of what are your preferred programming languages, what do you guys do? I mean, you know, what would be a good guess for a dominant programming language in this group if I had to pick? Java? Lot of Java guys. Let's see a show of hands. Java. Okay, that's like about good half the audience. Okay, what about some Scala? Maybe a fewer Scala users. Okay, then what about something like R? Okay, few hands there too. Lot of hands that I'm missing. So what am I missing? I was going to like not go with C++, but okay, C++. Okay, but that's actually like only like three people out here. Oh my God. Okay, JavaScript. Wow, we are in a revolution out here. Okay, well, some stuff like Ruby maybe? That's clearly on its way down, huh? Okay. Oh, Python, of course. Yeah, okay. All right. So we have like a mix of just about everything you can imagine, and now one more, Julia. So fantastic. So I'm going to basically focus much of my talk on the numeric parts and why Julia and why scientific computing and those types of use cases. But lest you be, I don't want you to believe that that's all Julia is good for. You can even build stuff like GUIs in Julia. So I would recommend that you listen to Shashi in the afternoon if you want to hear about how to build amazing UIs in Julia. So that's, I'm not going to talk about that stuff. I'm just going to stick to numerical computing for my talk right now. And here's one reason why Julia, right? So you guys recognize what this is? I'm not, without me showing the title of this document. Yeah, scheme, R6, yeah. So this is a scheme language spec, right? This is This is exactly what it is. This is supposed to be the cleanest, simplest language out there, right? I mean, you can't get any better at some level. Well, maybe you can, but you know, this is considered as a gold standard, right? If you look at the scheme specification, it's crazy how much of the specification is devoted to arithmetic and just numbers. Given that a programming language has a little bit to do with, typically most programming languages, right, have a lot to do with data, with control flows, with structure, with programming structures, I find it a little crazy how much is spent, even in a minimal language, on defining numbers and arithmetic. So, if you look at, there's a whole section on numbers, by the way, so that's right here. I don't know how to highlight this thing out here, but you get it, right? The section 3 has two pages on just numbers, but that's not where it ends. If you keep sort of, you know, looking through arithmetic, 39 to 47, right? 8 pages of stuff on arithmetic. I think this is probably the largest section of the manual. Like, there's nothing else that is 8 pages. Like, errors and violation, right? Clearly, like, that seems like an important thing to have in a language, right? That's like 1 page. Or macros, 1 page, right? I mean, such an amazing and important feature is 1 page. You know, pick anything that you want, right? Unspecified behavior, that's like, that doesn't even have a full page of its own. But numbers have 2 pages and arithmetic has 8 pages, and then of course there's booleans and all kinds of other stuff. Arithmetic and basic forms here again, there's another page on this. So a good 10-15% of the scheme specification is tailored towards numbers and the behavior of numbers. And the reason I mention this is, if you probably take all the code in Julia that expresses all the arithmetic and all the logic of numbers, it probably won't fill up 8 pages. And this is the executable code that I'm talking about. Julia does not actually, in its language, at its core, even define what these things are. Julia at its core defines data types as just a bunch of bits. So I can say that here's 32 bits, and by the way, tag them as an integer. And now I will define the plus operator on the integer and the minus operator and the, you know, the signed zeros and the unsigned zeros and all this. So all of this stuff which you would traditionally consider as low-level language features are actually not baked into the language at all. Arithmetic on integer, should they overflow or should it saturate, right? I mean, you can have a debate on this all day. Or maybe you don't care, that's also possible. You know, floating points, you know, should what? How many types of NANDs should you support, right? All these little interesting little things that people care about, right, are not actually sort of baked into the language. They are pretty much actually available in Julia. They're actually defined in Julia and they're specified in Julia, and I'll give some examples of that as I go along. So I'll just move on. This is an IPython notebook. What's this thing here? Okay. So let me pick a simple one to start with and go from there. Actually, I'm going to start off with the one on arithmetic, so modint. This is one of my favorite ones and it's a little esoteric also. So now we jump into Julia syntax, okay? What is what I'm doing out here is I'm defining, so this is a type definition in Julia. Julia has the mutable types and immutable types, so this is an immutable type. And what we are saying is that we are defining a new immutable type called modint, so basically integers modulo some number. And n out here is a type parameter. So this is a type that is describing all integers that are integers modulo n for a particular value of n. Okay? So for example, modint 13 is a separate type than modint 15 is a separate type than modint 25, right? So it's a parametric type, and all this says out here is how to construct, you know, this is the constructor for the type, and essentially just stores its value inside it. And this syntax says that it's a subtype of integer, so, you know, it, unless I specify otherwise, it will try to inherit, you know, the behaviors of the integer. All right, so let's execute this. I did that, and then So mod n 13 of this number, if I just do this, you know, this is what I get, right? So mod n, so this number modulo 13 is 4. So for example, if I have 13 out here, 13 modulo 13 is 0. If I have 14, you would expect it to be 1, right? So that's what it is. And so on and so forth. Okay. So at this point, let's maybe start mucking around with this, right? So I have A and I have, let's say, B. So can I do A plus B at this point? I cannot, right? Because I just created a new type and I have not told Julia what plus on these two things means. But I can actually. So in modular arithmetic, the way I would do plus is I would, you take the two values and then you add them and then you take the modulo of the result, right? So this is doing exactly that. Okay. But at the same time, let's do a minus. So actually, now that I've evaluated this plus, I'm going to run it again. And, you know, that's what happened with A plus B. You think this will work? Any guesses? Why? Yes. So one is an integer, and I haven't told the system how to add a mod n to an integer yet. So I haven't done that yet. But I can do that. Let me just execute. So you know, just like plus, I can implement minus. I can do star. I can do the unary minus. By the way, I don't like the way this is displaying, right? So I'm just going to evaluate this line, which overrides the show operator. So how this is actually printed. So as soon as I do this, now if I go back and do my A, I got a nice, yeah. So all I did was overloaded the show method on mod int and said just print it, you know, this way. So I have an interpolation in the string where the type parameter is actually inserted into the string and the value is inserted from the type into the string. Okay, so this is A and this is A plus B, right? So now we kind of, we can make it look nice. All right, and this is the compact show. You'll see why I need the compact show. Okay, so here promotion, right? So here is a promote rule now. This is where I'm going to define to Julia that, okay, A plus B plus 1 did not work. Why did it not work? Because the addition between a mod int and an int was not defined. Now, this is typically, you know, promotion rules are typically baked into the language spec, right? At least for primitive numbers and for integers and stuff like that. In Julia, there are just a bunch of rules that are told to the system by the, you know, with statements such as this. So all this is saying that if the system sees a type that is a mod int and a type that is an int, mod int wins. Okay? And if mod int wins, then you have to be able to convert an int to a mod int at any given point in time. So this is a convert rule. Okay, so let's evaluate these two rules. So convert is a generic function in Julia where when you define a new type, you can tell Julia how to convert an existing set of types to your type. So this line is telling Julia that if I get an int, convert it to a mod int by calling this method, right? This can be anything you want. So for example, all the conversions in Julia, right? If I have to add a float and an int, or if I have to add a matrix and a vector, or if I have to add a string and something as well. The nasty stuff like that is, you know, not defined, but you could if you wanted to. So all these conversion rules and promotion rules are actually specified in Julia, and what happens is that at compile time, Julia will, you know, figure out the types of all its inputs and actually figure out what conversion and promotion rules apply and then go ahead. So now that I have done this, right, now that we have defined these two things, let's just move this a little bit up here. So we had A plus B, which was working, and now let's try A plus 1. Okay, I've missed something now. Did I forget to evaluate some code? Okay, I don't know if I want to do live debugging of what I messed up out here. Yes, they are. So, let's Let's figure this out, maybe spend a minute. So int is int 64 on a 64-bit platform, it's int 32 on a 32-bit platform. Maybe there are some more methods out there that should work. Okay, I think I've run all this stuff in a wrong order, so let me restart this notebook and do a run all as soon as it's ready. Okay, let's see what happens here. Right, that was supposed to not work. I'll delete it. All right, so it's working now, right? Okay, so I can do a plus 5. I think I ended up defining the methods in a wrong order, and that's probably why I put myself in a bad state. That's the problem with notebooks. Okay, so now that I've done this, I can do, you know, a plus 5, I can do 1 plus a, I can do 2a, I can do... So by the way, the juxtaposition operator does multiplication in Julia, so it's the same as writing 2 star a. But here's the cool part. We didn't say anything about matrices at this point, right? So far, we haven't said anything about matrices in Julia. But we were able to do 2 times this matrix A, which I think has been defined like right here. Right, so this is a random matrix A that has been defined. Remember that I haven't even told Julia how to generate random mod ints yet, but it has been able to take a random matrix of integers, apply the convert rule that we wrote above, and convert it to a matrix of mod ints. And that's what it got out here. And then a to the millionth power just worked, because there is a generic implementation of the caret operator in Julia, which says if you have a matrix and you raise it to a particular number, what happens? And if you have implemented all the underlying built-in operators, it actually can compose them and do operations that you did not imagine it would be able to do. And so here's another one of those types. So this is basically, I think this is the real power of Julia, right? That it's taken all the arithmetic, all the mathematics that you need, and abstracted it into a simple set of language features which can compose very well, which are not baked in, and that the compiler can work with. And I think this is crucial, right? Because finally, when you want to write your machine learning algorithms, or you want to write your image algorithms, or your signal processing algorithms, in most systems like MATLAB or R, you have this sort of, you know, caste system, right? That if you are inside the system, if you are the R developer, if you are the R compiler writer, let's say, the language implementer, you have access to all these amazing first-class features that you can use for performance. But if you are outside, if you are an outcast, like most programmers are, from the programming language implementer's view, if you are an outcast, you don't get access to all these amazing features. In Julia, that's not the case at all. In Julia, whatever's available inside is also available outside. Whatever the compiler writer uses is also available to the users. And you can actually start looking into this stuff. So for example, which is the method that will get called if I do a plus 1? I can just say at which. So this is a macro in Julia, by the way, so I can write a macro. So all macros in Julia have an at notation. And this just told me that if I run a plus 1, it's going to call this routine, and then I just click on this, and I, you know, get sent to the Julia source tree, and I can actually look at its implementation. All right, so this is what happens when you do a plus b. Obviously, you know, if you get two numbers, right, of that can be of any type, you just promote them to a common type and then add them. So that's what's going to happen out here. And then if they're of the same type, what do you do? So this is the method that does that. And now you can trace what no op error does. And actually, finally, when you get down to the bottom of it, let's see what happens. So you can actually look at the code that gets generated. So this is the code that got generated for A plus 1. Actually, I think this is the wrong A, this is a matrix A. So I want, let's just call it mod int of 12 plus mod this will generate too much code as well. So A equals mod of something, and B equals mod of, and let's keep these in, let's say 15. So by the way, I've been using mod in 13 all along, right? Now mod in 15 is a completely different type. So the Julia compiler is going to see this as a new type and actually generate all the code internally to generate mod in 15. What did I miss out here now? Oh, all right. That's wrong. Yeah, A plus B. So this is the code that Julia generated for adding these two modints that I gave it. Right? Or I can look at the LLVM that this generates. Actually, let's look at, so this is the lower tree that Julia generates. So this is the first phase of the Julia compiler getting into action. The moment it sees that code, this is what it does. And then it will try to guess the types. So here you will see that types are being inserted even though I didn't have types in my expression out here. Julia is running its type inference analysis and it's actually beginning to populate types out here. So A is a mod int, this is an int 64, B is, you know, what is K, all that stuff. And then finally, you can look at the LLVM code that gets generated. Everyone here knows what LLVM is, right? Is there anyone who doesn't know? If you don't, I'll say a couple of lines. Okay. LLVM is a compiler infrastructure, so it's basically what, you know, is an intermediate representation that Julia generates, and then LLVM takes it from there to machine code. So it's the foundation of a lot of new compilers today. So this is the LLVM that Julia generates, and then finally you get the native code. And you can actually look at the native code, and it's not hard to imagine that if you're in most interpreted dynamic languages that you would not get anything that looks this tight, right? For something that was this abstract, right? A mod int to a random modulo being added to another random modulo int with all the operators sort of implemented all over. Okay. All right, so the last, I think too much of modulos, right? But I'm wondering do you think matrix multiplication should work? We have defined star and plus. Is that all we need to implement matrix multiplication? What else, what would be missing? Okay. Not a corresponding? Right. So there is a generic matrix multiplication already built into Julia. Okay, right. That much is there. So in theory, I think this should work, but I think it does work actually. Yeah. Oh, sorry, the questions are not probably getting recorded. Is that the issue? Okay, never mind. Yeah, so there is a generic matrix multiplication implemented in Julia, which is the trivial, you know, for loops. Well, it's actually a little bit more than the trivial for loops. The matrix multiplication is never trivial, but what it has is, you know, it will have the implementation of matrix multiplication going by the rows and the columns and all that stuff. So long as your array type implements the indexing that it needs, which is A of I comma j, it implements star and it implements plus, right? So algebraically, matrix multiplication, all it needs is a semi-ring defined over a plus and a star operator. And we have that. So I gave it this random new type and you could actually do matrix multiplication with it in Julia, right? So this is the power of abstraction, right? That I'm now able to leverage all the things that I never even knew about or wrote because someone else has written them. And this becomes increasingly powerful as people write packages and libraries in Julia that others begin to leverage. Okay, so while I'm on this mod int, why don't I also talk about an interesting facet about matrix multiplication? This is another of my favorite topics. And this goes to show the care with which we have built a lot of the libraries in Julia. How am I doing on time? I'm just kind of 20 more minutes? Okay. All right, so on the topic of matrix multiplication, if I had, let's just create a random matrix of, let's just make them ones. You can verify the answers, right? Okay, so I have A is my matrix of ones now, and B is my matrix of ones but of float 64s. Okay, so that's what B looks like. Let's just put a semicolon to suppress output. If I do, okay, so if I just square these matrices, right? If I take the first one, which is a matrix of ints, and the second one, that's a matrix of floats, if I square them, which one should be faster? And why? Sorry? I'm comparing, there's a matrix of ones, right, that I'm squaring. So A times A, and then the next one that I will do will be B times B. So I'm taking a matrix of ones, the same two matrices as integers and as floating point values, and I'm going to square them. Same operation, just a different type inside the matrices. Would you expect something to be faster, something to be slower, maybe the same? Technically, int should be faster. Sorry? Exactly, right? All the amazing SIMD stuff and word lengths and all that stuff, you would expect it to be faster. That's what I would also have thought. And let's check. There was someone else who had some other hypothesis. Let's hear them all out. No, we are not that smart yet. not there yet. Eventually. Int. Okay, any other views? Okay. Alright, so here's a test now. So this is, the first time there is always a compilation that kicks in, so at the JIT compiler kicking in, so there's always a little delay. So you always run everything the second time. So this took 1 second. And let's do, well, you can already tell that it's significantly faster with floats. Right, so 20 times faster on my Mac. Right, very tough to imagine, right, why this would be the case. And so the reason this is the case is because, and this is the 30 years of numerical linear algebra research. There is a specification called the BLAS, Basic Linear Algebra Subroutines, which has one of its operations in the BLAS is a matrix multiplication operation. And because it has been a standard for 30 years, almost any scientific code written over the last 30 years uses these Fortran BLAS libraries under the hood. And the specification is implemented by each CPU manufacturer to have the maximum performance of those operations, on those operations. Of course, it only defines the specification for floating point and complex floating point values. So it does not, if when they defined the BLAS had they stuck an int in there, we would have had int multiplication also be fast. And by the way, all the SIMD magic is already happening under the hood out here in Julia. So if you look at the code, my guess is you'll see it, or if it's not there, even if it was there, it's going to be very hard to come to the, close to this factor of 20. So matrix multiplication is an incredibly tough problem that people spend their entire lives optimizing, and you can benefit by it just by using Julia by typing, by just using float 64s. The float 64 version is using BLAS, and the BLAS that we use is called Open BLAS actually, which is from these guys, which was from these guys in China at one point. But Intel has their own BLAS, AMD has their own BLAS, IBM has their own BLAS. So it's really a standard that just works, and you just plug in the right BLAS for your CPU and like boom, like codes just become 20 times faster as compared to the reference BLAS, which will be even slower than this. Where did I lose my notebook? So there's all this knowledge or all this amazing folklore about numerical computing that, you know, you probably don't know, or you probably should not even care about, right? I mean, this is esoteric stuff. But if I just told you that if you work with matrices, just use floating point and the best, fastest things will happen under the hood, that's pretty good, right? I mean, you know, that's how you stand on the shoulders of giants, right? Someone did the work and, you know, someone else benefits from it, right? And not only that, I can even do an SVD of this now, right? I can compute an SVD factorization of this. I can compute principal components analysis. I can do all this amazing algorithms. I can, once I have my PCA, I can put it in a computer vision algorithm. From a computer vision algorithm, I can build a self-driving car. I mean, the list just kind of goes on and on, right? at some level. But if, as you peel layers from just about any sophisticated numerical code, you will find yourself coming down to these basics. You'll find yourself coming down to matrices, numbers, bits, operations on them. And, you know, leveraging a platform such as Julia, I think gives a lot of power. All right, so I've touched upon a little bit about the language features, right, about what Julia does, about its numerics, about the language. I think you guys have got a feel for what the language also looks like at some level now. If you have used MATLAB, it looks quite a lot like MATLAB. That's the most popular numerical language in use, and the syntax is friendly. If you are a chemist, you will not run away screaming looking at all the parentheses in Lisp. That usually is what happens. If you're a Python user, the language, you know, minus the indentation, it kind of looks similar, so not so foreign, right? If you come from R, probably you'll be happy that all those dollar signs are missing and not an eyesore. At least that's what I feel. If you come from C, the syntax actually feels very similar and familiar. In fact, your mental programming model, if you're a C programmer or if you ever programmed in C, your mental model of performance will transplant directly to Julia. So it's passed by reference, for example, and not passed by value that a lot of dynamic high productivity languages are. So everything that you have in your mind about programming C and doing, you know, good C programming, if you just use those same tricks in Julia, you will actually get code that runs as fast as C, but is written in Julia. Okay, so let's get rid of some of these things and move on to other things. All right, so this is great. Here's a fun, did you guys know that you can, there is actually a Batman curve? There's actually a mathematical function that defines Batman. Okay, so here's what it is. This is what it looks like. These are the bat functions, and this is a plotting code that takes different parts of the bat curve and plots it, and that's the Batman curve. Okay, this is a real thing. I'm not making it up, okay? Like, you can Google it. So, let me touch upon that. So this is the Batman curve. So this is using matplotlib from, so in Julia, you load modules with using, and there's a package called pyplot which wraps the entire matplotlib from Python. So we don't build all the stuff that we don't have to. But there's another amazing package called gadfly, which is completely implemented in Julia, and I'll show some demonstrations of that as well. But this particular example, this is just a fun thing that you can take your mathematics and look at this function, right? I mean, there's a bat curve, it's kind of like that, right? I don't know what you call it, upper cup? What would be the Likert? This is not a caret, by the way. So, another thing, in Julia, you can actually use all your full Unicode set is available for you to go crazy on. You can even do stuff like, I'm doing /alpha tab, and you can do, well, I didn't want to reevaluate the plot, but you get the idea. All right, so that's Batman for you. Let's leave this page. All right. Let me touch a little bit on parallel computing. I'm just going to sort of touch upon a number of different topics. Of course, I can't run this because I have not booted up this platform, you know, my EC2 instances with 1,000 cores. But you could, if you have a cluster with SSH access, it's trivial to make it part of a larger Julia cluster. You can add your workers, count them, and then just sort of start doing operations. So for example, here's something you would have never imagined to be able to do in a dynamic language, right? This is a parallel for loop running over a trillion coin tosses. Okay. So each processor is doing a billion coin tosses out here, and it all got done in 10 seconds. So randbool generates a random boolean value, this promotes it to an integer, and this is your map in some sense, and then this is your reduce operator. And I stick an at parallel in front of it, which is a macro that takes this loop, identifies, you know, this range, splits it up, assigns it to different processors, and then the at time macro just wraps it in a timer. So this is, you would not even do 1:10^6 on a typical Python thing, right? You'd never write a Python program that iterates over anything that's 10 to the power millions, I mean, 10 to the power something or in millions, right? Julia, of course, is a JIT compiler, so you would not mind doing this in C, for example. So if you don't mind doing it in C, you should not mind doing it in Julia. And this is an example of... The other interesting thing about parallel computing I'd like to point out is that this is a new area, it's an area of active work and research, but all of Julia's parallel computing libraries are actually implemented in Julia itself. There's nothing special under the hood. It uses the same I/O frameworks that are available, you know, socket communication, shared memory communication, all the stuff that's available to everyone else. It just takes that and builds that up into higher order constructs for doing parallel computing. So we have distributed arrays, we have parallel maps, we have remote references, so all kinds of parallel models that people are playing around with, Oh, and by the way, we are also adding multi-threading. So Julia is almost thread safe now, which means you can actually start, this is actually running as multi-processes. So if you do parallel computing on your desktop also, you'll end up spawning multiple Julia processes and doing IPC amongst them. But as soon as threading will become, so threading, we just branched off Julia 0.4. So 0.4 will release in 3 weeks from now or 4 weeks from now. And multi-threading will be available as an experimental feature in Julia 0.5, probably in the 3 to 6 months time frame. It's already available on master if you want it. You just need to know what makefile flags to use. So a lot of work going on in the parallel computing domain. Okay, next one I'm just going to focus on more of the algebraic and linear algebra stuff. I think if you want to hear about Julia as a programming language, Shashi is your guy. I think you should hear his talk, where he'll touch upon some of those things. So what a singular value decomposition is, if you don't know what a singular value decomposition is, raise your hand. Okay, I think that's pretty much everyone. But you heard about it in your college when you wondered why the hell I have all these matrices and do I really have to deal with them. Okay. So singular value decomposition at its core is just, it's a matrix algorithm. You take a set of matrices and you decompose them so that A equals U times S times V. Okay, it's just a factorization. That's all it's doing. But the important point about that factorization is that you get a set of orthogonal vectors which represent your space. So what you can do with a singular value decomposition is basically, I can do an exact decomposition, which means if I multiply the factors, I get the exact result back. Or I can say that, you know what, I don't want all of them back. Let me do this on the command line. I just find it easier to use Julia on the command line often. All right, so let's just say that this is, 5 by 5 matrix. Let's just take a random 5 by 5. Oh, what the hell? Let's take a normalized, rand n 5 by 5. Rand n is from the normal distribution. Rand is from the uniform distribution. So if I say SVD of A, I get U sigma and V equals. Let's just do it this way. Right. So I get this U matrix. I get this S, which is the singular values. So and I get this V. Now, the way the singular values come out in a singular value decomposition is that they are sorted from the largest value to the smallest value. And without getting into the math, what you can say is that I don't want a full decomposition, I just want a partial decomposition. In this case, let's just reconstruct the matrix A using these two values, right? Because the remainder of them are not as large as the other ones. So the basic idea is I can construct an approximation of the original by using its factors and throwing away much of the information, and I just keep the information that corresponds to the largest values. So in some sense, if all of these values were 1, then it would tell me that, you really need all this information to reconstruct these matrices. But in this case, it's telling me that clearly the last one is not that important at all compared to the first two. So let's just say I'll take the first two. So I would have to take U of, I'm just going to use the first two. So from the U matrix, I'm going to take this. Then I'm going to take two out of these. And I'm going to take and reconstruct the original. I think I've messed up somewhere. I think I need to do this. And then I need to do this. So that I get the 5 by 5. And then if I do minus A, So I got some approximated version of this. Do I have to do a transpose? No. Just a second. Let me just see if I can get this right. Okay. I always keep forgetting if the transpose has to go on or not. But this is a low rank approximation. Right now, it's not easy to see what's happening with these numbers, right? But you got the idea. But let me show what happens with a picture. So this is Gilstrang. This is one of our common demos that we use and we love. Have people heard about Gilstrang? Anyone used his linear algebra textbook? I think there's already one person there, two people. Yeah, several people out here, right? Yeah, but probably most of us have used the Shomp series or something like that. I suggest go and just Google Gilstrang linear algebra lectures and, you know, your world will change probably. At least it did for me when I did that. Okay, so that's Gilstrang out there. So this is Gilstrang in red, greens, and blues. And now, what did I mess up? I think I did a pkg.update, which I shouldn't have done. Sorry? I think I did. This is a colors package that got updated last night for me. Okay, let's just run this whole thing again and hope it works. Why is it not getting through? All right, it's doing something. I think this should be colors, right? Do one more restart. If this works, great. Otherwise, we'll move on to the next thing. But I think this is a really cool demo. I really wish it would work. Okay, so that's the first, second, and let's see what the, yeah, okay. All right, so at this point, I'm reconstructing that image that I loaded, right? So these are the red, greens, and the blues out of that image. And I have a for loop which is using this package called interact that Shashi here has built. And that gives me this slider. So I can move this slider around and pick a value from the slider. And based on the value that I pick, I can reconstruct that image with that many components. So for example, when k is 1, you get this. So if I wanted to reconstruct that image with just one principal component or with one principal piece of information, that's what I get. So this is, you can kind of see this is like two vectors being multiplied, right? Because there's a vector going down this way and there's a vector going down this way. And you know, you see this is the kind of pattern you see if you just multiply and take a outer product of two vectors. But now as I add a second vector, right? So this is a matrix multiplication happening under the hood, right? But what's really happening is that I'm using two singular values, right? So I have an outer product of the first set of vectors, and now on that I'm superposing an outer product of another two vectors. So I've added more information to it. And as I keep increasing this, at 7 you can pretty much tell that this is probably the same image, right? The original image to reconstruct would need 300 of these. But pretty much we are able to throw away, and if you go to like 20, right? I mean, these two images are pretty darn close, right, already. And if I go to like 30, it's becoming pretty hard to tell now, right? If it's even changing much, right? So this is the power of linear algebra, right? I mean, and this is signal processing, image processing, whatever you call it. And these are all the things that we sort of build on Julia, one on top of the other. I'm going to take another last quick demo on this fluid images. I just like showing images because it's nice to look at in a demo. Otherwise, looking at numbers is kind of boring. This is another one of Shashi's notebooks, actually. So this is the conference, right? This is our conference thing. Let me just run this whole thing. So what is happening here is this is an image seam carving demo, and what it's doing is basically is finding the lowest energy seam in an image And the idea is that if you remove the seam, you're removing the lowest energy part of the image. And without going into too many details about it, I'll just show what happens. That's kind of the most fun. So this is what a seam looks like. So the slider picks where the starting point is. So I pick the top of the first line of row of pixels, put the start my computations from there, and then it will sort of go down and figure out what the seam should look like. So for example, if I start at a different point, this is what the seam looks like. Okay? So these are all the seams possible in this image. And the idea with a low energy seam removal is that if you remove these seams, you are losing the least amount of information in the picture as you compress it visually. So for example, let's go down where this thing really is. Yeah. So this is the full image, right? This was the original thing that I started with. And now every time I'm moving this slider, whatever is that red line is being deleted. Okay. In real time, I'm kind of doing this, and then so there's a visual compression of the conference logo. You can kind of tell, right? You could tell that this was the original one, but it's kind of being squashed now. But you can still, all the key icons are there, all the dates, all the text. The image did not get removed, right? I mean, so this is a typical seam carving algorithm that gets used for these types of things. The interesting thing is that if you do this in Python, you could not even use an image this large for doing it in real time. You'd have to do something that's like really tiny, because it would be really slow. Julia, you could actually have a much bigger image and do it in real time. Okay, so, yeah, all right. So I think I'm going to stop at this point. Hopefully I've given a sort of a good flavor of what Julia is under the hood, why Julia is the way it is under the hood, why it's good for numerical computing, the amount of care that we have taken to build these things. And over the last 3 years, you know, it's all these amazing contributions from the community. The core Julia project on GitHub has actually over 400 committers, just Julia itself. There are 600 packages, and you can call almost every Python R package from Julia. So pretty much the entire world of numerical computing is available at your fingertips in Julia with all the performance and productivity. And with that point, I'll maybe take any questions if there are. Yeah, you can use the mic, I think people can.
So, some of this stuff are really awesome to look at. My question is more around, what are the next plans? What is the focus of the language going to be more around parallelization and numerical computing, SIMD, the scientific computing side, or will there be constructs around some of these things going to any other area? I mean, what would be the core focus of the language? Because, like, for instance, the matrix multiplication that you showed, it was awesome, but I wanted to understand if that can be used to do some other kind of task, right? What's the focus
you
of the
mean
language?
Like a non-numerical task?
Yeah.
Okay. So, as the language evolves, what we are going to do is, we started out with a language with a focus on numerical computing. That was our background, that's where we came from. But what we found is that as we've evolved Julia, it has become an amazing general purpose programming language. And one of the things that's actually going to happen as we go towards 1.0 is that the mathematical libraries will be detached from the base. So the base of Julia will become very small. So the core Julia language compiler runtime will become tiny, incredibly small, compact, very low memory footprint that can be put into a web server, it can be put onto a device, it can be just about anything. The mathematical library will continue to be part of it, but maybe a module, so you'll have to import it, but also in ways that you can replace more and more of it, right? I just showed a few things, and we'll make it more modular, more replaceable, so that even fancier data structures can be easily brought in without having to have everything in base. There will be an increased focus on multi-threading and parallelization for sure. That's the key focus for us. At the same time, we will improve our GC and our memory footprint so that we go down to even lower form factors. So today we are already on ARM. We want to run on even constrained, more constrained form factors as we go along, as well as run it on the largest data sets, terabytes of data that you can imagine. So design will become increasingly sharper, cleaner, nicer. another key thing that's coming out, two pieces which are incredibly important for our language ecosystem. One is there's an IDE which is based on Atom that will be adopted as a standard by the community. And the second thing that's coming out is a debugger which will be is close to release. And there'll be, by the way, it's incredibly hard to get a debugger for a language like Julia, which is completely jitted and is using LLVM. And we find ourselves fixing a lot of LLVM and compiler bugs that Apple and Google are not fixing to make our debugger work, but it'll be there, and in the next couple of months, you'll have a real debugger along with it. So that's the, in short, what all will happen as we go towards 1.0. Yeah?
Julia will be able to overtake Python. Do you want to do that at all? And if so, more specifically, what is it going to take?
I really don't know. I mean, would I want to be as a creator of something? Yes, of course, I'd like to see wide scale adoption. Will it overtake Python? It's a hard question to answer. I really don't know. I think Julia clearly has a niche that it's good at, and I think in that niche it is definitely, I already can see it becoming a dominant force going forward. So will it even replace all the MATLAB and R codes that are out there? Obviously not, right? Nothing ever gets replaced in computer science. You just add more stuff, right? And the same will happen with Python. Actually, we have an amazing coexistence. So Python calls Julia, we actually have demos of Julia calling Python, calling Julia, calling Python all the way. And I think as we go forward, there will be closer collaboration between the two communities. I don't see Julia replacing Python in any way, actually, to be honest.
Not replacing, but I mean, it's fantastic that there's
Right, right, exactly. Right. Right.
I can parse my raw data, I can do my very advanced signal processing stuff and push it onto a database and on a web backend or whatever it is.
So I didn't
entirely in Julia.
I didn't show any of that stuff, but all that is possible today.
Excellent.
That is already possible today at a much higher performance that is available in Python. So there are always things like pandas which are really good and which have been written in C, so we always are catching up to that. But our goal is not rewrite a whole bunch of internals in C and match Python speed. When we are slower, we say, what do we do to the Julia compiler so that it becomes as fast as writing hand-coded stuff in pandas? So we may not be there now, but the workflow that you said is 99% already there. And whatever is missing, it's a few lines of code that you can always write in your own application. So database wrappers are already there. In fact, we are going to, so I am a co-founder of Julia Computing, which supports Julia. And all of our customers actually want this, right? They say this is great, a great prototyping environment, but we want to put Julia in production. So database wrappers for NoSQL databases, people are beginning to ask. MySQL Postgres has just become pretty much standard. There are web servers in Julia, there's Julia box out there, so all kinds of amazing stuff already exists, and I couldn't showcase all of it. But all of this will be showcased at JuliaCon Bangalore, which happens October 9th and 10th, almost a month from now. And I would really encourage you to try out Julia and submit a talk about your experiences with Julia. I think it's going to be run by HasGeek, so the funnel will open up like a couple of days. It's already open. The funnel is already open, it's not publicized yet. JuliaCon.in, yeah. Actually, why don't I just load that while someone else might have to see it. Please feel free to cut us off, yeah. Oh yeah, I should show C call. So it's trivial to call C programs from Julia, and let's just do that right away. C, and the same applies for Python as well, by the way. Everyone knows the clock function from the standard C library, right? Does anyone have Julia open? Well, you already know what needs to be done. Okay, this last one, and then we'll move on. So you don't need a C compiler to call any C code, right? Typically, in most programming environments, you have some wrapper that generates, and then you have a C compiler that will kind of create some .so, and then you load it, and like all this process that happens. This is how you call any C function from Julia. and you can pass in any inputs, you can have any return values out, you can do all sorts of crazy stuff. So literally just interactively, by the way, I can also, this is not going to work, but let me try it anyways. Yeah, I broke my build, sorry. You can actually do interactive C++ from Julia. This is really cool. Like, there's nobody else who can do that except some guys at CERN. They have their own system for doing this because of like the crazy amounts of data the hardened collider generates. But you can actually, so we have a collaboration ongoing with them. You can say using CXX, and then you can say include IOStream and hit enter, and it will evaluate it and print it. And you can say cout hello world on the Julia REPL, like right here, and it'll just work. That would be another thing that we do really well, yeah. Thank you very much.
All right, thanks Viral for coming in today, this morning, and helping us understand a little bit more about Julia. Hopefully you guys got a kind of quick preview into the language. I would encourage you, as Viral pointed out, to kind of go in. Julia box, are we doing a Julia box free version like last time we did?
It's open for everyone.
Now it's open for everyone. Last year we sent out, after the conference, whoever wanted to sign up, a sneak preview into it. But now it's available online, so anyone can go look at that. All right. Cool. Thanks again.